Yeah, thanks a lot, Mark, for the kind introduction and this rare opportunity for me to give such a talk via the internet, which I have not done so far. I will talk about one topic which I found particularly interesting, and that is the visual exploration of blood flow. That means we do not have only static data, but we have flow data. That means vectorial data, and vectorial data that even may change over time. So we switch over to the presentation, and we start with the first slide. Yeah, the very first. So maybe even one. Yeah, now we have it. Yeah, so that's what I wanted to describe, the visual exploration of simulated and measured blood flow. Blood flow may be measured with special image acquisition devices that has a low resolution and it is noisy. It may also be simulated, but that is based on a number of assumptions which are not validated for a particular case. So therefore, there are pros and cons of both acquisition techniques. So first, I want to make a few general remarks on blood flow data as a research challenge. And then there are basically two case studies. The first is to discuss simulated blood flow for treatment planning in case of a vascular disease, and that is called a cerebral aneurysm. Cerebral means there are vascular structures involved in the brain, and an aneurysm is something where you have a dilatation of the vascular structure that may lead to rupture. And I want to describe the pipeline, how we generate data for the simulation, how we use the simulation data, and how we explore the flow. The flow is quite complex with simulated and with measured blood flow. So there are various research approaches how to simplify this, and one of them is flow clustering. So as a result, then you have a few clusters instead of many, many streamlines, which are very hard to really understand. The second part is measured flow for cardiac diagnosis, and I will just look to the watch how much time we actually have. Maybe I have prepared a little bit too much for 45 to 50 minutes. We will see. Yeah, I want to start with a few general remarks. I think that the visualization of blood flow data has become an important branch of medical visualization in the last 5 to 6 years, I would say. Of course, blood flow data is related to other flow data. So people in medical visualization start to use techniques that have been developed by others for 3D flow visualization, dense flow visualization techniques, texture-based techniques, also topology of the flow, and adapt this to the peculiarities of blood flow. That means we want to understand also the morphology of vascular structures with their very complex shape and to see the flow inside. Yeah, there are line-based techniques like streamlines for static data and path lines for dynamic data. Topological structures are really important, as I will show later with respect to the cardiac example. There are many publications in medicine where they correlate certain patterns of the flow, embedded vortices, for example, with certain pathologies. So that seems to be really important. Flow simplification is important because otherwise it's just too much data and too difficult to understand. Flow may be simplified by clustering, but also by attribute-based selection or other techniques. I think in the visualization community there are at least four groups actively working in this area. There is the group from Anna Villanova and Roy van Pelt in Eindhoven. Anna is now in Delft more. The group from Gerig Scheuermann in Leipzig, where Sylvia Born was quite active, and Hans Christian Hege together with several PhD students. Yeah, a few general remarks on measured flow and simulated flow. Flow may be measured with a certain variant of magnetic resonance imaging that is called 4D PCMRI, phase contrast imaging. So that is really patient-specific data that is nice. However, the data is rather noisy. Also, the image acquisition takes a lot of time, and therefore there are artifacts, motion artifacts, for example, and also inhomogeneities, which are typical for any kind of magnetic resonance imaging. So it is challenging to process this data. That means you must to suppress some artifacts and compensate for them. Simulated flow, on the other hand, is nice and clean and has no artifacts and noise, but it is based on a number of assumptions. For example, usually it is neglected that the vessel wall changes over time. It is assumed to have a rigid wall, yeah, which is not completely true. Also, it's not true that this fluid is completely non-Newtonian, and you assume a certain inflow profile, a certain speed profile that is based on the literature, but it is probably not the exact inflow conditions in that patient. There are three different approaches to do this blood flow simulation. Computational fluid dynamics is probably still the most important one, and it's also the favorite method of our cooperation partners. So therefore, everything I will show in the following is based on computational fluid dynamics, but I want to mention that there are alternatives meanwhile. I want to present two case studies. As I said, the simulated flow is used to understand cerebral aneurysms. Actually, cerebral aneurysms cannot be characterized by measured blood flow because these vascular structures are very small in the brain, and therefore it is not possible to measure the flow there. The measurement of flow is possible with larger structures, for example, with the aorta. And the simulation is used not only to understand the current situation of the patient, but also to predict how the flow will change after a certain kind of treatment applies. So it's really involved in the treatment planning process. The second case study will be on measured flow, and it is used for the diagnosis of cardiovascular diseases. We have a number of cooperations with cardiologists. We got, meanwhile, a little bit more than 60 data sets from healthy volunteers, but also from people with various diseases like a congenital heart failure or heart valve defects. These are typical diseases where people are interested in flow patterns. And the flow is analyzed on the one hand quantitatively. That means people are interested in how fast is the flow there or how much flow goes in the wrong direction, so-called backward flow, and the stroke volume, but they are also interested in flow patterns. Yeah, in both cases, hemodynamics, the blood flow is one part of the diagnosis and treatment, but of course it's not everything. The morphology of the vascular structures is also taken into account. For example, if there is an aneurysm, such a dilatation of the vascular structure, it is important to understand in detail the shape and also the size. Yeah, there are giant aneurysms which are very large. I switch back to this slide again. And other shape characterizing measures are taken into account. Vascular pathologies are also characterized by a specific biology. Yeah, something happens at the cellular level. So what would also be very important is to understand the vessel wall, the composition of plaques, for example, in coronary vessels. That is also important. I will focus here on hemodynamics and the flow, but the bigger picture is to take into account also the wall characteristics and the morphology. Yeah, what on the heck is a cerebral aneurysm? Here you see an example. I should really point on this. There is a weakened vessel wall, and that leads to an increased vascular structure here, and there is a high risk of rupture depending on the particular size and shape of such an aneurysm, and when that happens, almost half of the patients really die, and the others are severely hampered in the following. So that is something you really want to avoid. More and more of these aneurysms are detected incidentally. People go to the hospital, get an MRI scan of the brain because they have headaches, for example, and then it turns out, well, they have an aneurysm. And the question is how this should be treated, whether or not it should be treated, because the treatment itself is also involved with some risks. Basically, there are two families how this could be treated. The first is the surgical treatment. That means the aneurysm is clipped. Yeah, it is just dissected here. That's a neurosurgical procedure. The brain has to be opened. The skull has to be opened. So that is really something which takes a lot of time. The alternative, more patient-friendly, is endovascular treatment, where a catheter is moved inside the vascular structure, and then a stent, for example, is implied here. Wired structure, which should prevent that flow goes into the aneurysm, and then the the aneurysm is likely to cease and it will be no longer there. But this is not always possible. If the vascular structures are too narrow or too strongly curved, it's just not possible to move a catheter so far in the vascular system. Here you see such a stent and you also see coils. Sometimes both are combined in order to treat such a cerebral aneurysm. In particular, instable flow and complex flow indicates a higher risk of rupture. There are many investigations from biomedical engineers with rather large databases which showed this, and that was a motivation for us also to deal with such simulation data. Another motivation is that the number of treatment options increases more and more. The question is not only whether a stent is used or not, but these stents have very different materials, different densities of these struts. Sometimes they are coated, yeah, that may help. A special new variant are flow diverters. These are very, very dense stents. And therefore, the question is which of these different treatment options is most successful, likely, in this particular patient. Here you see an example of patient data that is derived from CT data of a particular patient. And the situation here is something which is not untypical. This patient has three aneurysms simultaneously. So if you have a condition of developing aneurysms, then it may easily happen that you develop not only one of them. And the most pressing clinical question here, which of these aneurysms should be treated first? Because that's a risky intervention, and they would not like to treat all of them simultaneously, but they would like to start with one of them. Here you see the surface models that we have derived from these data, and these are used from the simulation people in order to perform their CFD simulation, and that helps us to come up with good visualizations for the clinicians. The image data we use for this are either CT angiography data with a certain resolution or MR angiography data or MR time of flight data. That's another variant of magnetic resonance imaging. Now you see that the resolution is even better with the MR data. Yeah, here are examples for these kinds of data. And then there is a whole pipeline that is necessary to create simulation models based on these data. So here you see this thresholded original data. Then we have defined a region of interest, which you see enlarged here. And we apply some filtering, vesselness filtering, to emphasize elongated structures. And then we can generate a first segmentation. And we use a connected component analysis in order to really restrict this to one result. We delayed the result a little bit and then use marching cubes in order to get a first geometric model of these vascular structures. This model is not very well suited for the simulation because of two reasons. The first is it is too large. The simulation guys want us to use clipping and cutting in order to restrict the domain of the simulation. And the second problem is that the triangles here have not a very good aspect ratio. That means several remeshing steps are applied to generate triangles with a better triangle quality. And that is used then from the simulation people to make an internal mesh consisting of prisms and tetrahedra and to come up with their simulations. Before I show the results, I want to highlight a few artifacts that typically occur. One of them is that these vascular structures here seem to be very narrow. Yeah, close to this large vessel, they are narrower than they are in reality. That's a typical artifact, and that needs to be corrected, because you can imagine if you have such small structures here, then this would result in very fast flow, but this flow is not correct. That needs to be corrected. So we apply several editing steps with tools like Blender to correct this. And after a first correction, then of course we also have to remesh the area where we have applied some. For example, we had to discriminate two structures which touched each other, and that is the remeshed situation here, which is a good input for the simulation people. What we did first is to understand with how much accuracy and resolution the simulations should be performed, because they really take a lot of time. So here you see a comparison between two simulations of the same data. Once we have a little bit more than 200,000 elements in the simulation, three-dimensional elements, and here almost twice as much. And you see that the basic results are the same. Qualitatively, it's the same. There are only slight differences in quantitative values. So we use a rather coarse simulation grid. That was first result. You see here, there is the date included, 2007. That was the first blood flow simulation, and that was what the simulation people created, and they went to the neuroradiologist and said, well, that is what we found out about your patient. And then the neuroradiologist says, well, my world is this one. Yeah, these are cerebral structures which I am aware of, and can you provide a better correlation of these simulation results shown here? And the anatomy. So I should not press too much on this. Sorry for this. I'm just back. That was the slide we have seen. And we looked a little bit into volume rendering solutions in order to provide more anatomical context in order to make this understandable. So we applied a couple of histogram-based operations and filtering in order to derive vascular surface models based on the data sets. So here are four examples where these vascular structures are extracted. And we use this in combination with a volume rendering with an appropriate transfer function to show where the vascular structures with the cerebral aneurysm actually are. We have discussed the level of detail, the colors, and came up with this kind of volume rendering in order to show them where the vascular pathology actually is. As the next step, we wanted to show the flow and want to enable the users to explore the flow. And for this, it turns out to be useful to derive some landmarks of these vascular structures. One landmark that is important basically for all kinds of vascular diagnosis, that is the vessel center line. Yeah, that is determined here with a special toolkit, vascular modeling toolkit, so we know first the center line. The second landmark we wanted to identify is a so-called ostium, that is a curved plane that discriminates the parent vessel from the actual aneurysm. A few further structures we have derived, that is the dome point, that is the point where the distance to the ostium is the largest, and we define a so-called central aneurysm axis, that is the connection between the ostium and the dome point. And we use these landmarks first in order to overlay them to the visualization, but also to restrict the exploration and the visualization. By the way, we started to define these landmarks by asking neuroradiologists to tell us how they would characterize the ostium and the dome point and so on. Yeah, so that was a first step. Then we had to do a lot of experiments, of course, and it turns out that we could rather reliably discriminate the ostium from the aneurysm, the center lines, and also discriminate a far vessel region and a near vessel region, that is where we are close to this ostium, where the flow enters the aneurysm. This kind of flow is particularly interesting. So here you see a number of examples from these different experiments that we did, where we wanted to discriminate the ostium, the near flow region, and the far vessel region for different data sets. So that is all automatically calculated and not manually drawn. Yeah, and that could be used in order to explore the flow. So now we have get back the results from the simulation people, and we applied transfer functions to better explore the flow. And these transfer functions, which you see here and here, for example, are applied to the speed of the flow. That means here we emphasize slow flow, which is important because if the flow stays for a longer time in the aneurysm, that is interesting and that's not good. But we are also interested in particularly fast flow, which you see here, because if the blood flows very fast to the aneurysm wall, This is involved with a higher risk of rupture. Yeah. Here's another transfer function where we have emphasized backward flow and forward flow, yeah, so that you can easily discriminate this. Yeah, so that can be enhanced. Here you see just close-ups of the upper row. Yeah, here we have shown this ostium plane, and we have separated with this red line the inflow region and the outflow region. We have added velocity glyphs so that it becomes obvious how fast the flow goes into the aneurysm. And we use the center line in order to move a widget always perpendicular to the center line to see this information orthogonal to the vascular structure. And I will show a short video based on the based on the submission for the Eurovis 2000. I think I can skip the first minute. So yeah. So here you see this ostium plane which we defined and the flow, and in a few seconds you will see how either the fast flow or the slow flow is emphasized, and yeah, that was welcomed very much by the users, by the neuroradiologists. Yeah, of course you have this 3D interaction which is difficult for users. That's something I often notice, to rotate 3D structures, to zoom in, to see something. So we often think about camera control and providing some guidance for this process also. Here this is without any such guidance. Yeah, that's now the fast flow which is emphasized. So this speed attribute is used here in order to show something. Yeah, I think that's enough. We may switch back to the presentation. Here is it. Yeah. So hemodynamics is strongly influenced also by the morphology of the vascular structure. So what we wanted to do is to show simultaneously the outer vessel wall and the internal flow. What you see here is, I would say, the standard approach. That means the vascular surface is shown transparently and the flow is shown inside. What we wanted to do is to combine both things better and to adjust the transparency adaptively, so that in regions where the morphology is particularly important, we see the morphology, and that's particularly in the outer parts of the vascular structure. Whereas in regions where the flow is important, we better see the flow. Yeah, and here is an example of a work that Rocco Gasteiger did, a comparison between the standard technique and his technique, where he better could show the vascular morphology. That's a kind of smart visibility techniques. That means where we have flow, the flow is important and is shown with preference, and where we don't have the flow, the vascular surface is shown. These landmarks are also overlaid here. These black lines indicate the inflow region, the ostium. We look again in a video from Rocco this time. Yeah. By the way, these are all videos from the YouTube channel from our working group. Yeah. Again, we may skip a little bit at least. Yeah, that's the standard method, I would say. Yeah, global transparency, and it looks pale. Yeah, it's not very expressive. And that is what we wanted to improve with a more adaptive smart visibility-like technique, and also with these landmarks. And then a further refinement is to remove the hidden flow also. That gives an even better impression. Yeah, so that was the second thing we developed. And we may switch back to the presentation. Yeah. Last year, Kyla Won from our group further improved this. So you see here the standard method, the method that Rocco developed, and a method that Kai developed, which is probably even better suited, was presented at VMV last year. And so that's a shorter video. I think we can show this in detail. Kai has meanwhile provided a journal submission based on this conference publication. As I said, the major goal is that you see simultaneously the vascular morphology and the internal flow. That may even help the neuroradiologists to understand that the simulation may not be perfect. Yeah, they see that something is very unlikely, and then they look at the morphology and see, well, maybe there's a segmentation artifact. There was a long pipeline of preparation steps, and there may be something wrong. Yeah, so that is this new technique. Yeah, I think that's enough. This video. We also looked a lot in the interaction technique of lenses. So we wanted to understand which pairs of attributes are interesting to explore together so that the user may move a lens over the data and see, for example, pressure inside and speed outside the lens. So this is freely movable, not here in the presentation, but in principle. And was considered also a nice technique in order to explore the flow data with its many attributes. One of the last things was provided by Steffen Oelze in our group. Steffen is a specialist in visual analytics, and he dealt with clustering, and he applied this to blood flow data, to the streamlines of the simulation, and he wanted to show only the representatives per cluster in order to give a better overview of this data. The similarity measure is based on geometry, of course, but also takes into account attributes like speed and pressure. Here, this is used for treatment planning. So here you see such stents involved. These are simulations with different kinds of stents. That is part of the virtual cranial intra-stenting challenge. That means there is a data set to be downloaded by the community, and people should develop solutions how this patient should be treated with stents, and that should be simulated. And we look again in a video. So I think I wanted to skip the first 40 seconds or so here. Even a bit more. So there's the aneurysm, the ostium plane, the inflow region and the outflow region. And then you will see the streamlines, many streamlines. You are not even sure whether there is a vortex or so inside. You would not notice, whether there is helical flow or so. That is rather dense visualization technique. Yeah. And with clustering, this may be significantly reduced to per data set. It's a little bit different, sometimes 10 clusters, 12 clusters, 9 clusters in this area. Yeah. And of course you may select an individual cluster which is then highlighted so that it is easier to follow this particular cluster. That is of course also included. Yeah. So that was something which we did recently in order to simplify the flow. Yeah, I think that's enough. One more thing which I think is a very important directive for this research in the future is there are some flow characteristics that are often described by medical people which are not very clearly defined. They think about, is there an inflow jet? That means a region of the flow where it is highly concentrated and has high speed and is coherent. And we came up with an attempt to mathematically define what is an inflow jet. And if there is an inflow jet, then we can show this. The inflow jet is shown often together with the impingement zone, that is the area at the aneurysm wall where this inflow jet arrives at the aneurysm wall. And that is very important. I think that's the last video in this part, also part of Rocco Gasteiger's PhD thesis. I think that's again the same aneurysm. It's not that we only have one data set. I think we have 24, but that was used very often for a number of presentations. And in fact, that was also a data set where an inflow jet occurred. Yeah, so that is the overall situation with many streamlines resulting from the simulation. And I hope that we soon see the inflow jet, which is automatically determined by a number of parameters, of course, discussed with neuroradiologists and validated in order to make sure that what we see there is something that is really relevant, yeah, that is this inflow jet. Yeah, that's all good. Yeah, I think that's enough with this. So I have a little bit more than 10 minutes. So as a summary of this, I think that the exploration of simulated blood flow is helpful in order to diagnose these vascular diseases in the brain, but also to treat them. In the future, there will be possibilities also to measure this flow with better MR scanners, 7 Tesla and 9 Tesla MR scanners. And the visual exploration, of course, needs to be carefully adapted to the workflow which physicians, medical doctors have to define. We did this so far for 26 data sets, which is not enough to make statistical investigations, of course. We want to combine measured and simulated flow once this measurement is possible, and to include it, include a thrombosis model, which would biologically simulate what happens there if a certain flow would arrive. So, and I take 10 minutes or so to show a little bit what we did with measured cardiac flow. First, I want to show you a list of references where I have emphasized all these situations where flow patterns are mentioned and emphasized. So in all these publications, a physician looks at the data and he seems to see helical blood flow or secondary flow and investigates how often this occurs and how it is related to a certain pathology. So these are some of the expressions that are used by medical doctors. Yeah, nested helical flow, pronounced vortical flow, systolic flow patterns. Yeah, there is the cardiac cycle, there is systolic flow and diastolic flow, and that is used to describe the flow. And again, we want to do this in a mathematically correct and more quantitative measure. 4DPC MRI is a kind of MRI measurement. Here's an MR scanner. What is more common meanwhile is to make flow measurements only in 2D. That means for a plane you have defined before, 4DPC MRI is still a rather recent method. The first publications are from 1996, but it is still not a widespread method. These are the raw data here, so you have 6 data sets, and based on these 6 individual data sets, the flow is derived. There are artifacts, of course, the heart is beating, there are magnetic coils that leads to artifacts, and another severe problem is, in advance, you have to specify the maximum velocity you would expect, that's the Wenck parameter, velocity encoding. If this is too low, then you get phase reps. That means that is exceeded, yeah, and these are the black points here, yeah. There you have phase reps that need to be corrected later. As I indicated, there are many papers meanwhile that indicate correlations between vascular pathologies and flow patterns. Statistics are done, and yeah, that is what we want to support and where we want to help. Together with people from Fraunhofer Mewes, we are able to process the data. That means we can correct eddy current artifacts and phase unwrapping. For segmentation, we use a temporal maximum intensity projection. Then we apply the Martin Cubes algorithm and some mesh processing in order to come up with good vascular surface models. And then we have the internal flow here seen with these many yellow lines. Yeah, Runge-Kutta 4 integration is performed. And what we wanted to do first was to show vortices, yeah, where we have a vortex flow. And we use a line predicate technique where we can combine different attributes and attribute-based selection in order to understand, in order to filter the flow. Actually, this is a video. What we do not show here, we would see a reduced set of streamlines here, which unfortunately does not happen. These line predicates are applied to a whole path line, not only to individual points, because with individual points, it may happen that a path line would be interrupted. That's not what we want to have. Either a path line is shown completely or it is removed. We need a lot of smoothing there in order to, yeah, to come up with good results. So here you see the comparison whether smoothing is enabled or not. We have looked in a number of vortex criteria, how we actually characterize a vortex. You may imagine that we strongly work together with Holger Teisel's group, which sits close to us. We have looked at all these criteria, and the Lambda 2 criterion is the best one. So at least here we have one video which we can show that was the submission from Ben for the, is this enough? For the WIS conference last year, where he has presented it. The mouse is away. Now there is a mouse cursor again, and I hope we can see this video also. Yeah, that was the supplementary material of Ben in order to show vortex patterns that are automatically found in this PCMRI data. We have looked in healthy volunteer data, and as expected, there are no vortices inside of them. Only minor helical flow is typically in healthy volunteers. But we also looked into a number of patient data sets, patients with congenital heart diseases or with valve defects of the mitral valve, for example. Yeah, and we could find these vortical areas and could emphasize them and enable our clinical partners to combine this knowledge with what they know about the patients. So maybe I think that's enough with this, and let's switch the last time to the presentation. So this Lambda 2 criterion was the best to extract these patients. Maybe I skip a little bit these detailed patient descriptions. One kind of pathology we have looked at is a bicuspid valve. That is a healthy valve, and that is a tricuspid valve. It has three parts, right? And in some patients, that's a kind of congenital heart disease. It only has two patients, and then it is really interesting to see how the blood flow changes and whether or not surgery is important to correct this. Yeah, that's not always necessary. Yeah, again, I skip some of these examples. All this is integrated in a tool, Bloodline, which we have meanwhile delivered to our three clinical partners so they can evaluate their data sets on their own. Hopefully they tell us what they are doing, because they are more or less independent. Meanwhile, there is a lot of functionality in order to import the data and pre-process them. There is a graph cut-based segmentation of these 4D data, so we can show the flow inside the moving dynamic vascular structures. Yeah, these vascular structures change a lot due to the heartbeat, but this can be incorporated. Then people are able to place a plane inside the aorta, and they can see how the flow speed changes over time, how the flow rate changes over time. These are some kinds of the evaluations they know from tools like Siemens or Philips. Therefore, we wanted to include this as well. But they cannot automatically classify vortices or helical flow or other things. Yeah, a lot of quantification takes place. An interesting point is the regurgitation fraction. That is how much flow goes in the wrong direction, in particular close to a valve. A certain amount of flow is not critical, but if this is more than 5%, it gets critical and often indicates that surgery is important. Yeah, so with this, I'm at the end of the talk. I hope I could show that the visual exploration of simulated flow and measured flow